Oh, I'm up. Yeah, okay. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hello. Okay, so this is an experiment for me. I do a lot of talks. I love doing talks on several subjects. Actually, this one is 2 years old by now. And I even have a new slide with a scoop for a new project that I'm starting. But that's at the end, if you're still awake then. Okay, so let's start with the experiment. I can introduce myself in a high impact way and in a low impact way.
Do both.
Trust me. So the first question is, you have to make a choice by raising your hands, whether it's high or low impact. Who is in favor of a low impact? Okay. Who is in favor of a high impact? Be careful what you wish for. You just might get it. But it's an introduction, right? It tells you really something about me. At the end, I'll probably ask you if I overdid it. And I should never do it again, right? So keep that in mind. I'll ask you later. So and it keeps you all awake, right? That's also our benefit. Yep. Now I have to click on this one. Yeah, that's it. Okay. I'm a father of five. And I have three girls. My wife has two girls together. For those numerical challenged, that's five. And as you can see, it's not a standard family. One of them is actually single, so if you're a nice guy, but you get me as a father-in-law. You know, I'm the kind of guy with T-shirts like 10 rules for dating your daughter, with one being get a job. You know, that's me, and my girls hate me for it. Oh, no, Dad, no. Yeah, of course I do. Okay, I've been a firefighter for 10 years. So a few pictures of me saving a dog. This is my helmet. This part was melted. It was an exercise, and it was hot, and it was great fun. But yeah, I had a melted helmet. I do something with Boy Scouting. I combine that with firefighting. This is an event in the Netherlands with 5,000 scouts every 4 years. I'm author of several books. I'm now working on my 9th, so this is just something to get you through. And I'm a caretaker, and that's where you see some pictures that sort of represent the impact that it has on my life. Oh, by the way, I'm also the LibreRent project leader. That's the logo up there. It's an open source project. So, that was the high impact slide. And now the question, because I don't want to commercialize on a sap story. So it's an honest question. Should I do it again or shouldn't I? Who is in favor that I should do this again?
Not today.
No. Good. Okay. Thank you. This helps me, you know. Okay. So this is the low impact, boring. And I'm also a member of the Angry Nerds podcast team in the Netherlands. We do it in Dutch and great fun, by the way. What do I do? Remote systems management, you know, some consultancy, some training, and I write my main project and web-based project management. Very cool. Are there people in the audience who are native English? They come from the UK. 1, 2, 3, 4. Don't have to be really reluctant, you know. We all know what happened, you know. okay, so for the real British people under us in our community, small community, the Dutch speak English, but we do everything literally. So this is a translation table. If a British guy says, "With all due respect," he means, "I think you're wrong," but I hear, "Oh, he's listening. He's respecting me. We've got a nice dialogue going," you know. So it's not that I want to be impolite. It's just that I don't understand the intricacies of the real English culture. Okay, what's a mainframe? Let's get to the subject. mainframe basically is massive hardware parallelization. So what they do is you have a computer with a CPU and you try to offload the boring tasks as much as possible to dedicated hardware. That's it. They've been around since the 50s and they're still around. And this is just, you know, you got your processors, but if you want to store something, it goes to storage control and that takes care of the rest, main storage. Or it says, no, go to control unit from the storage control to devices or tapes, whatever, but it's offloaded from a processor. So the processor can focus on what's it really good at, being some simple calculation. Now, this is not, I repeat, not a supercomputer. Because a supercomputer, it's all about doing as fast as possible, as many calculations as possible. And that's for mathematical models, you know, weather models, analyzing what's happening in the world. Global warming analysis, for instance. This is just throughput, getting data as quickly as possible from A to B. In a banking system, you've got millions of customer records, and they all, every day, they get a very small interest. Well, you used to get interest on a saving, right? But in those days, it's like, okay, we've got millions of records. They all got every day a single piece of interest added to it. So all those records, every night, go through the system, calculated, stored, done. It's nothing mathematically challenging or about it, but it's just throughput, massive data throughput. Now, what's Hercules? Hercules is a mainframe emulator. Maybe you know of Keemu, KVM, Hyper-V, VirtualBox, whatever, whatnot, platforms where you can virtualize hardware. This is one that virtualizes a mainframe. It supports System 370, ESA 390, and a 64-bit Z-bit architecture. And it runs on Linux, Windows, Solaris, where you can read what it all says. How does it look? Well, this is an actual front panel of an IBM 360. And this is sort of, well, this is the GUI, you know, with the rotary dials and a sort of a console in there. And here the hardware configuration for this particular instance of a mainframe, because you have several options. You know, how many hard disks do you have? How much memory do you have? Whatever, whatever. And so you configure the hardware for this particular mainframe to run. What does it do? Well, it runs software. Many OSs are in the public domain. They're old, but in the public domain. If you have a license and the hardware from IBM, you've got an IBM license for something and the hardware combined, then you may also run that software on Hercules, because they've already sold the hardware. Well, most of us don't have the hardware. Actually, that brings me up. There was a point in time where I got the option to buy a hardware really, really cheap with a mainframe. And it was a cute, small system, about a cubic meter of metal. And it looked really high tech. And I went to my wife, and that's the only time she said no. And trust me, because I also collect AS400s, and I have seven. And this, I thought that would be nice, you know, in the living room, put a vase on it with some flowers.
I had a son into my room, and my mother had me threw away.
Yeah, it's... okay, so if you don't have the hardware, like I do, you can use OS360, DOS360, DOS-VM, MVS. We're going into that later on. VM370 TSS and Linux. So you can have run Linux on a Hercules mainframe emulator on Linux. I don't know why, but it's possible. Now, what not to do? Because this presentation came forth out of my frustration looking into this. So I'm going to tell you everything I did wrong so you can hopefully do it better. At least don't have to experience my frustration. Don't Google Hercules project, because it will get you to hercules-390.org. And at the bottom, it will say last update 2010. And you think, that project, right? Wrong. And if you then go to there and you follow the site, you come to some J. Maynard. And there's an easy start mentioned, Volkers MVS3.8J turnkey system version 3. And there's even an email for Jay Maynard. Don't do this. But it's there. And it's an easy mistake. A long time I thought this guy was deceased, because I mailed him, no reply at all. And then I found this. Eric Raymond has a project, an open source UPS hardware software. In the wikis, there's this Jay Maynard in the people list. He's alive. Now, you make up your own mind about this next thing. Because on May 1st, there was an email, I ain't dead. And I may not be involved in Hercules anymore, but I haven't gone anywhere. But he runs the old website, .org. He has admin for the mailing list on Yahoo with 7,000 members. But he's not interested. He doesn't do anything anymore about Hercules. So nobody can administer the mailing list. Nobody can administer the original website. So if you didn't know better, you think, oh, it's a dead project. Make up your own mind what you think about this. Well, what you should do, go to the same site, but .eu. Should I make the joke or not? Yeah? Even if you're British. Sorry, had to be done. The main list is Hercules 390 at Yahoo Groups. It got 7,000 members. Easy start is MVS G3J Turnkey 4-, not 3, but 4-. There is a new release with some URLs. I'll put the slide. Well, they are already online, but anyway. And you can start learning. Moshix is somebody who has made a lot of videos on YouTube explaining you how this system works. And you can start working with it. What do you need? A PC with Linux or Windows. I know, it's possible. Raspberry Pi even, a 3270 terminal emulator, because that's a protocol that you need to talk to a mainframe. But it's already in the Linux repositories for years, so no problem there. Hercules software, I would advise to download that turnkey system, because it's a zip file. You unzip it and you've got everything. You've got Hercules latest release. You've got MVS installed. You've got boot scripts, etc. It's very easy to get. Actually, when I did this talk at OrgCamp in the UK, August 2018, somebody in the audience did it while I was talking, and later on the podcast said, "Yeah, I did it while he was talking, and it actually whatever I what I said actually made sense and it worked." Who knew? okay, Hercules and some operating system distribution. Now, this is a very small mainframe, a Pi Zero, smaller than the original manual. Lingo to understand. These are the words that are used in that in the mainframe community that you don't see outside of it. DASD, Direct Attached Storage Device. Hard disk. Right? TSO. Time sharing option makes it multi-user. So you could have a mainframe without TSO and you would have a really, really expensive single user system. Jest2 is a job entry system, release 2, there's also a Jest3 in the release or almost in the release, I don't know. But it's for queuing jobs because that's what you do. You submit a job, it gets into a queue, at some point I don't know, because actually this is a subject I know nothing about. Really, I'm not a mainframe expert, so I advise you to look into that. I'm a Linux guy. I've been in Linux for 20 years, and I came across this, and I found this interesting. So this is one of those talks that I should start with. I'm going to do a talk about something I know nothing about. There is Kix, front-end to transactional software. The data set is created assigned space for stuff. Which means if you want to do something on a mainframe, you first go to the sysadmin and you request a data set. And then that data set gets a name, 15. Okay, thanks. The data set gets a name, and in that data set you can make files and data and do your stuff. But it has a fixed size. So you can never cross the border of the fixed size data set, which is a very easy, old but easy and simple way of volume management. Yes. And a catalog is a system list of available stuff. So if you add software to it, you also have to edit the catalog to make sure that it knows that the new application is available. If you know these terms and know what they mean, you can fiddle around with a system like that. What you will see, this is a terminal session to a TK4-dash. And you've got a log on. This is back in the day when security was, shall I say, non-existent? Because you can do user ID/password. And everybody can read the password. But you can also do user ID enter, and then the password is hidden. So yeah, they really did some modernization. After login, this is the menu you're presented with. And you select an option. And normally I would give a demo, but we don't have the time to do that now. But some things you need to know. This is the position where you need to enter the menu choice. If you are outside of that position, the terminal itself will lock up because it doesn't understand what you're doing, because it's a screen-oriented communication. You enter something in the screen, you send the data to the mainframe, he does something and he sends you a screen back. With masks, yeah, that's a good term to explain that. So if you do that and you lock up your screen, no worries, there's a reset button. Just press the reset button. It won't reboot your mainframe. It'll just unlock the status of your terminal and give you a new shot to enter the choice over there. Now, the other thing is you need to know a few function keys. The F3 is back. So if I select option 1 to go into submenu 1, if I want to go one level up, F3. And the other thing is there were no page up, page down keys on a terminal keyboard, so they used F7 and F8. If you can remember those three, you're fine. Together, of course, with the reset button. Okay, demo time. Don't have the time. Performance. Okay, comparing an i7 processor to a real IBM Z14. That's a really recent mainframe. This is on TK4-. Yeah, I've got my TK4-. Let's say first test, 350 million instructions per second. Okay. This is the one for a real mainframe, 5 billion, almost 6 billion instructions per second. So it's a little bit faster. If somebody can do the calculation about the factor, but I'll help you. This is just about, you know, it's not an exact science, but
not that much.
It's not exactly. It's
a machine that costs millions of
Yeah.
Cool.
And you can run this on your laptop. Actually, I think this is a laptop. Anyway, update in April last 2 years ago. He had 61 video. He made the system available, Moshik, so you can send a TSO login request. And he has a virtual machine with this stuff, and you can connect to that. So if you don't want to install it on your own, you can request a login. I also asked the mailing group list for how old are you? And I got 7,000 people, you know, I got about 30 responses. It's not a lot, but it gives you some statistics. Average age, 62.6.
The others were writing on paper.
So, if you remember the title of my talk, running a mainframe on your laptop for fun and profit. Well, the fun part, I think I've clearly explained that. Now, the profit part is they're going to retire. And this is a low-level way of familiarizing yourself with how a mainframe works, albeit a system from 1972, but nevertheless, a mainframe. You know, conceptually, nothing much has changed. And then you can apply for a job, and believe me, they love to see you, because current people knowing how to program COBOL, 10 minutes, easy. People knowing how to program COBOL, even if they learned it on Hercules, you get a job for a very nice hourly rate. There's a company in the Netherlands who says, we'll hire you, give you a job, then we will train you in 2 weeks, and then we'll put you at a bank to do some work. So if you don't have any computer knowledge, you can still get a job there. Okay, playing with the hardware. Silly me. Suppose I want to hook up a real terminal to Hercules. I asked that in a mailing group. And the terminal uses coax cable. So somebody said, oh yeah, that's easy. You just need an IBM 3594 multiplex coax to HDLC, which is a serial synchronous protocol. Optional, you can do that with an Ethernet module, which is very rare. And if they are available, it's very expensive on eBay. Or you use an optional token ring module, not so rare, because at some point token ring was pretty popular. Well, not so much popular, but let's say Ethernet 1, but there was a time that it was about even. So you need a token ring hub and a Cisco 2650 to bridge token ring to Ethernet. Now, if you do all that, you get this setup. So it's weird, but you have your coax from the terminal coax to here. Then this is your token ring. Token ring goes to the Cisco that's not on this picture. From there it goes to, the token ring goes to, because you need an active token ring hub. So token ring goes in here because something needs to be active in a token ring network. From there it goes to the Cisco. From the Cisco you route it to Ethernet. Ethernet you go into a standard Dell, maybe running CentOS 6 with a token ring adapter. Or I come to you in a second. Or just a simple standard Ethernet. And then you have a real terminal session to your Hercules emulator. Yes, sir, you have a question? Over here.
It's not rare.
No, it's possible, and it's like I just said, it's supported until CentOS 6, I believe. And then you don't need the Cisco router, and you don't need, but you still do need the active hub. And because this thing still doesn't talk token ring. Okay, did I answer your question? Okay. Now, if you want to skip the hardware, I just want to experience this warm, sort of glowing, nostalgic screen, this warm amber or phosphor tints what's the term in English? The days of yore, right? Is that, you know what I mean? Okay. Then there is, sorry? The days of yore is the term, right?
Yeah, I feel like dinosaurs.
Yeah, like the dinosaurs time, that's about it, yeah. So there is this project on GitHub called Cool Retro Term, and then you can run this in a terminal emulator and saves you a lot of headaches because you don't have the hardware. And it still looks original. Okay, my new friends, during the preparation of this talk, I actually made a few friends. Who knew? A lot of guys in the S390 mail group, really, they're very welcome to newcomers. Maybe it's an age thing, I don't know. But, you know, they're helpful. They like to, everybody who's new in this, because they are, like some of us here, love Linux or FreeBSD. don't want to step on any toes here. and they love their mainframe world, so they're very open to questions. Moshe Bar of the Moshe's YouTube channel, lovely guy. You can ask him anything. And I found Sam Gollop. He even called me. He's in Texas. He lives in Texas. I live in the Netherlands. And then the phone rings and it's Sam Gollop. And who is Sam Gollop? Well, the CBT, that's the mainframe tape distribution. It's like a Linux distribution, but it's a tape with tools for the mainframe. And He's been a maintainer for the last 25 years, and his predecessor did it for 17 years. So you have one distribution of tools that's 40, at that time, 43, so it's now 45 years old. So that's pretty impressive. In short, it's a wonderful new work world for fun and profit. Update in April 2019, Moshik has 130 video terminals, and there was a free XR initiative from a Dutch guy, because MVS-XA was where MVS does maximum of 16 megabyte storage. Storage means memory, the RAM. MVS-XA was released with more bits on the address, so maximum 2 gigabyte of storage. So they petitioned IBM to make, not for the source code, but to make the binary distribution license free for hobbyists to use. And it was a very nice initiative. They had some a little over 1,000 people signing the petition. By now, we know IBM has answered. Okay, IBM has answered this request and denied, saying, no, we've got this new emulator that's not Hercules. It only costs $8,000 for a PC, and we love you to buy that. So, unfortunately, no 2 gigabyte of storage. Because, well, their reasoning behind it for the initiative was, you know, this is 30 years old operating system. There's no chance that it's still in production and competitive to what's currently offered at IBM. But clearly, there are still people living in a closed world. Scoop, my new hobby project, completely open. This domain there's no website, there's not even email, because I just registered this a couple of days ago. Is there anybody who knows what this is? Oh, this is very cool. Yeah. It's a display unit for the Apollo a moon shuttle thing. And it's only the DSKY, this for display keyboard display. And currently my 3D printer is printing all these parts. There is already somebody who sells a print of that's similar to this. Similar. It's not a huge amount, but he keeps the PCB design files closed. But for the rest, it's open. I'm now studying KiCad, I should be able to reverse engineer a simple display with Arduino behind it. I don't know how much time it will take, but you need to have a hobby, right? So thanks for your attention. What frightens me is that people actually making photos of this picture now. Oh, your meal. Oh, okay. Oh, thank you. Okay, questions. Yes, sir.
Since your link, my disguise doesn't work.
Sorry?
Since your link, my disguise
doesn't
work.
There's nothing
new. Wait, no, like I just said, it's not live yet. I've only registered the domain. I didn't have time yet to put up at least a dummy page, and even email is not yet routed. Yes, sir.
Usually we look at retro computing systems in a benevolent way, because we know that the technology is old, is no more in production, so we like to tinker with that. But this stuff is very, very active and very in production. What, even the emulator has dials. Why should I do this to myself? I don't understand, because it doesn't look there are some practical technological reasons beside legacy.
So the question is, why would I do this to myself to look into Hercules?
To learn a mainframe.
To learn a mainframe.
Besides the fact that there are still projects who are trapped.
Currently, at this point in time, every year there are 5 billion lines of source code in COBOL written. Added to the current code base.
Added.
Wow. New lines, all corrected, but anyway, new lines nonetheless,
why
in a way.
Why are they doing this to themselves?
Why are they doing this to themselves? Okay. Actually, if you pay for mainframe, it costs a lot of money. You have 30, 40 years of history in COBOL development on your mainframe, and then somebody comes up to you and says, oh, look, we've got this new language, be it Java or Python or C, and we can translate everything onto a PC, which is a lot cheaper. Mind you, it doesn't have the throughput, so you need to cluster it. There's not a single PC that can do it as quickly as mainframe. And then you get a question of the biggest business case. What does it cost to maintain your current situation and keep developers and everybody working on it? What is the yearly price for that compared to translating 40, 50 years of software development into new software? Sometimes you've lost the source code. So it's like, I think it did this.
You lost the source code history,
yeah. And there is just no business case. Often there's just no business case to, what's the word for it? Justify porting everything to a new platform.
Five billion.
Yeah, 5 billion. Okay, yes, sir. A data set is data files. Data files are text only. So there are no databases on MVS at the moment. Well, there are some developments. There's still development on MVS with free software tools and utilities. So I believe there's also a TCP/IP stack in the latest releases. And that you could use to connect, let's say, to Postgres, which is, of course, a fantastic database, and implement a client-side library, just pick pglib and translate that to mainframe system calls and try that. Unfortunately, my time's up. I thank you all for your attention, and have a nice weekend.